Welcome and thank you for coming on behalf of Palgrave Macmillan to our panel discussion, Voices Lost and Found, which is marking 50 years since the decriminalisation of homosexuality. And this is part of the Being Human Festival run by the School of Advanced Study at the University of London. My name is Vicky Peters, as it says there. I'm the Editorial Director for Humanities at Palgrave. And we're always very proud to be able to be part of this festival each year. It's a great privilege to be able to host an event of this kind, and we're unusual among academic publishers in having a lovely event space like this. We at Palgrave Macmillan are highly committed to our publishing in the humanities, and we publish a lot. As well as being committed to publishing the best in scholarly research, we're also very committed to promoting public engagement with the humanities, and to encouraging interdisciplinary debate and discussion. And we have been for just shy of 175 years. We're involved in today's event through our campaign for the humanities, which is an ongoing suite of publications, promotions, web events, and live events like today's. And moving on, our chair this evening is Sean Brady, who's here, and I'm going to leave it to him to introduce the rest of the panelists to you, but I will say a few words about him. Though, for anyone who's interested in the history of sexuality, I don't think he needs much introduction. Sean is a lecturer in modern British and Irish history at Birkbeck, just down the road. He's convener for the History of Sexuality seminar series at the Institute of Historical Research. And from a Palgrave perspective, as well as being an author, he, along with Joanna Burke and John Arnold, is series editor for our Genders and Sexualities in History series, which is, on the subject of anniversaries, is about to celebrate its 10th anniversary, I believe, and is up to 49 books. So it's an incredibly prolific and important series as far as we're concerned.
Now, it is wonderful to mark and celebrate this 50-year anniversary, and it is an anniversary of the passing of the Sexual Offences Act of 1967, and especially here at Palgrave's headquarters tonight, as well as the series and the books that are published forming their own intellectual forum through Palgrave Macmillan. We also have an intellectual space here at Palgrave Macmillan, which allows, as you say, public engagement and, you know, an opportunity for authors to meet the public. Now, I think it's important for us to remember, although this is a 50-year anniversary, it is a celebration with very many caveats. Yeah? First of all, the Sexual Offences Act only partially decriminalised sex between men. You know? Men could only be two men in private, and it really conceptualised, you know, the meaning of the private and identity for the very first time in English law. And it was men over 21. So even though it was better than what went on before, it was a partial decriminalisation, and gay men in Britain lived with that discrepancy in the age of consent, which was only grudgingly reduced over many years, literally within the last 15 years. It's also important to remember another caveat, that what we're celebrating tonight is a half century of the Sexual Offences Act and partial decriminalisation in England and Wales only. Yeah? That piece of legislation was eventually, and again, very, very grudgingly passed 10 years after the findings of the Wolfenden Commission in the late 1950s argued that sex between men in this country should not be criminalised and the criminal laws be removed. And it took 10 years for the legislation even to get into the House of Commons.
Now, my work is, as Sean said, among a far less represented group. That is not just lesbians, but older lesbians, women over 60. And I do a lot of oral history work. And so I actually hear all the time those unheard voices and those previously untold stories. Okay, so what, if anything, did 1967 mean for lesbians? Well, the usual cultural assumption about lesbian life in the 1960s goes something like, lesbians never had such a hard time of it as gay men, of course, because they were never illegal. And I have often had this said to me, usually by members of the audience, when I'm speaking about these things. Now, my research suggests that prosecution is not the only kind of persecution, and that actually lesbians were having a very hard time indeed, but more or less invisibly. And for most women in the late 1960s, lesbian or not, feminism actually hadn't happened yet. And I think this is a very important thing to remember for this topic tonight, because it brings us to one of the major differences between lesbian and gay male history in the 20th century. No, we weren't illegal, but my God, we were second-class citizens. If you imagine two young women, look, here are two young women in 1967, two lesbians. Imagine these two girls setting up home together in that year. And you can see how all the disadvantages of being a woman were doubled for a couple of lesbians. Women's pay was lower than men, or was lower than men's. So a lesbian household's income was lower than that of their heterosexual peers or of their gay brothers. They couldn't afford high rents, therefore. And as women, they weren't eligible for a mortgage. They couldn't buy their furniture on hire purchase unless their dad or a brother would sign the contract for them. And they had no redress against discrimination at work, either on grounds of sexuality or of gender, which was a scary situation for a household with no male breadwinner. And it's hardly surprising then that many of the women in my study were active in the women's liberation movement in the 1970s. Many of them found their lesbian identity in the context of feminism. In fact, if you asked a lot of older lesbians what important Act of Parliament was passed in 1967, they would almost certainly say the Abortion Act, which was obviously a milestone in feminist history before they thought of the Sexual Offences Act. So I'd like to argue that the 1967 moment gave lesbians a little bit of media attention, which wasn't entirely welcome, and very little else, because their moment of change was still in the future. And it would be the Women's Liberation Movement rather than the Sexual Offences Act which would prove to be the watershed that put lesbians on the road to freedom, both as women and as lesbians.
It's a real honour and privilege for me to grab any opportunity I can to talk about John Addington Symonds. And this evening, I'd like to focus in on just a single voice and its story, and how that story has been lost and rediscovered and retold across the years since John Addington Symonds' death in Rome in 1893. See, in 1889, he began what I consider to be his most extraordinary writing project. He began to put together his memoirs. And in this letter to his best friend, Henry Graham Dakins, he describes this new project as a foolish thing to do. This is a foolish thing to do because I do not think they will ever be fit to publish. Of course, in 1889, putting his life experiences down on paper was potentially a foolish thing to do, or incredibly brave, depending on your perspective, and certainly unpublishable. He was also, at this stage of his life, convinced that his was a relatively unique story to tell. He had not yet begun the research into the sexual sciences that he would do in the final years of his life, when he would discover other men's stories, and he would discover the language of sexual inversion. This brave new world, it came too late for his memoirs project. Now, he dies in 1893, and he leaves that manuscript to his friend, his literary executor, Horatio Brown. Horatio Brown does the dutiful thing, and he uses that manuscript as the backbone, as the basis for an authorised biography of his friend that was commissioned by his surviving wife and family. It, of course, removes all explicit mention of homosexual acts, and it very strictly mutes or alters implicit references to homoerotic desire. Later, in the 20th century, Symonds gets another biographer and another editor, a Canadian scholar called Phyllis Groskurth, who was working on Symonds for her PhD at the University of London. The biography, the work on the left, that comes out in 1964, 3 years before the Sexual Offences Act. The memoirs, the edition on the right, that comes out in 1984, after the passing of the Sexual Offences Act. And they're very strikingly different works. I'd like to take you through what happens to Symonds' voice before and after partial decriminalisation. As a biographer, Phyllis Groskurth's hands were tied. Horatio Brown had put a 50-year embargo on Simmons' manuscript. She could not quote directly from it where it was unpublished. She could only paraphrase and summarise his words. She was also working in that 10-year period between the Wolfenden reports and the Sexual Offences Act, this sort of suspension, this moment of suspense, I suppose, between the recommendations and the implementation of the Wolfenden report. 1964, no critic before had ever been so explicit, so frank about Simmons' sexuality and about the memoirs, but she's ventriloquizing him. His voice, his words, they haunt that biography, and I think she uses an appropriately gothic description. Simmons' bones are the skeleton framework hidden within the flesh of her words, her account.
So when I started my research into same-sex desire, in the north of England particularly, I expected to find something that was similar to what I'd read about in books written by people like Sean and people like Matt Holbrook, who I'm sure you'll be familiar with. But I didn't, to cut a long story short. I found a world where, actually in the period before 1967, some working class men were having sex with each other, seemingly without guilt, without thinking about what that meant to their identity. They weren't meeting in bars or at parties. They were often meeting at work. It was often something that came out of friendship. And when I talk about work, I'm talking about traditional industrial work like steelworks and mines. And this is just another picture to show you just the inside of a steelworks from the beginning of the 20th century. And what this shows us is how hard this work was. You know, these guys are balancing big vats of molten metal between them. And what it meant was that friends, workmates had to rely on each other to the point of actually you might die if, you know, somebody did something wrong. And this creates a kind of comradeship in this environment that you could say is kind of similar to war. Obviously not quite as extreme as that, but that danger leads to a very intense friendship in those kind of working environments. Now I just want to move on to the hotbed of vice that was Rotherham Town Centre in the 1950s. Yeah, it looks exciting, doesn't it? But you all wished you were there. But actually, I'm just using this to highlight the fact that there were lots of different ways that men used to meet each other and have sexual relationships in the north. And Rotherham is a mining town, is a town centred around steelworks. And actually, there was a great scandal, really, in the 1950s, just before this picture was taken, around one of the steelworks, where this kind of hidden life became, you know, part of the record. And it was to do with a works trip from one of the steelworks down to the Festival of Britain in London. And actually on the coach down, lots of men had sex on the coach. So that was actually before even the party at the Festival of Britain. So it must have been a good weekend trip. And we know about this because it does come to the attention of the police later down the line. But it shows how kind of friendship, the work environment and sex mingled. Out of this climate though, it means that there's never been much of a gay scene in Rotherham or Barnsley or Sheffield. This is an example of one of the gay bars that opened in the post-1967 period, but there haven't been many of them and they don't tend to be very successful. And this one is located in the old steelworking district, which reflects some of the stuff that I said before. And what tended to happen, rather than having a specific scene, like in London or in Manchester, there were lots of mixed bars and working class bars in areas like this around the steelworks and around the mines, where people would just go in and do their thing and not have a specific identity or a specific space. And this is an example here of really the one remaining gay bar left in Sheffield, which is, it looks quite imposing, I guess. It doesn't look that nice, really, does it? Yeah, it looks quite grim. And this is one of the reasons why we still have that culture in a lot of cities in the north now. The impact of 1967, then, was quite complicated in the north of England. So, of course, it was liberating. for those men who did see their sexuality as an identity. And it opened up all the opportunities for those men that it did for LGBTQ people everywhere else. But it also meant that the culture I've been talking to you about this evening changed and died, basically. Because it was now much more difficult in the wake of 67 for men such as the ones I've spoken about to move fluidly between friendship and sex and back again and doesn't really matter and, you know, don't really care what this means. And because the age of identity politics made us think, you know, made people think about what those things meant.